What is up, my peeps? Joshua Smith here at GSD Studios. First off, thank you so much for checking out today's content. I'll make this extremely fast, but I need to plug our sponsors that make this show possible. Our first sponsor is PerfectStormNow.com, by far the most effective and affordable real estate agent website and database platform in the industry. It is the system I use to sell 50 plus homes every single month. Check it out at www.PerfectStormNow.com. Our second sponsor is my personal 90-day mastery bootcamp, which is, again, my personal real estate agent mentorship program where we spend 90 days together, 12 live sessions. You get daily access to me inside the program. You guys, we go so extremely in-depth. There's nothing that's incomplete about this program. You're going to get all the tools that you need to go out there and crush it inside your real estate business. Make sure to go check us out, www.90daymastery.com. You can watch in-depth videos of exactly what's covered to see if the program is for you, see all the raving testimonials we have from all of the amazing agents and clients that went through the program. So make sure to check us out, www.90daymastery.com. All right, you guys, let's jump on in to today's content. What is up, my peeps? Joshua Smith here with another GSD Mode interview where every single week we interview top entrepreneurs and just straight up top badasses that are choosing to go out there and dominate their space and not live a life of mediocrity. So today, you guys, got a special guest on the show. This is a young entrepreneur, 24 years old, took the leap, right? He had an amazing corporate job. Yeah. Took that leap. He was unfulfilled, took that leap, got into real estate. And he's only been full-time in real estate for about 4 months now. And check this out, you guys, he's already taken a $15 million listing, the highest price listing in his area. Yeah. One of the other things that's really impressive is, you know, he's kicking ass on Instagram, right? So he's gotten very niche specific through Instagram and other things too, like door knocking, which we'll get into, but exploding his business with that. So really stoked and honored to have Mike Sherrard on the show. Welcome to the show, my friend.
Yeah, man. Thank you so much for the intro. It's been a pleasure, as mentioned, of sort of watching your videos and leading up to real estate. It's what got me kickstarted on the right foot. So everything you do is so valuable, and it's an absolute pleasure to finally be here on here with you.
Yeah, man. Means a lot to you. I truly appreciate the kind words, brother. So before we get into what you're doing now with Instagram and some of the other strategies that you're doing, you know, let's talk about why the transition existed, right? Because I know so many people that are in that position that took the corporate, you know, path to maybe please their parents or whatever, and they just don't feel fulfilled. But it's kind of scary to make that switch, and then they just kind of get stuck. Like, what ultimately led you to the decision to leave this great engineering job to take the plunge into real estate?
Yeah, man, it's daunting for so many. So essentially what happened is, going into university, I knew that I liked cars, I liked math, I thought engineering would be the route. And I figured the best way to fulfill my dreams was to get a good job and climb the corporate ladder like many do. And in my sort of last year of university, I started reading books, things like Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and all the typical ones, you know, Think and Grow Rich. And essentially what happened is I realized that there was just more out there, and people have known me for my work ethic from working from 4 a.m. till midnight every day. And I realized that I just wouldn't reach my potential if I stayed in the corporate world. So after I got into engineering, I went from zero to helping manage a group of 750 people on a $3 billion job in a year and a half, which was unheard of. And I just felt like I plateaued. And I saw so many people who were in their 40s. They were stagnant. They were stuck and unhappy. So while it was a big move, it wasn't hard for me because I knew that in order to achieve my dreams and fulfill what I want to do in life, I had to just leave. And I did that. So real estate sort of came about for a couple of reasons. One, everyone knows that it's one of those industries where you get sort of rewarded based on your work ethic. Now, on top of that, I have a business partner back where I'm from in the East Coast, and his father owns a structural engineering company. And our long-term plan is to take that over and start doing large-scale development. So using real estate as a huge stepping stone to get in the industry, build a brand and a positive reputation, it just seemed like the perfect fit of incorporating my skills and my long-term plans.
So when you're making that move, dude, because I know a lot of people, again, they get, you know, it's like most people's biggest regret on their deathbed is not going after and creating the life they wanted. And they didn't create it out of fear of being criticized by others and what others may think about that, you know? So did you go through that, you know, or were like your parents and people around you supportive, or were they like, what the hell are you doing, Mike? Like, you got this, you got this like golden ticket here, dude. What are you doing? You know?
It's been crazy, man. It's a bunch of both sides of it. So I had my parents who were extremely supportive because they know my personality and my drive and what I'm going to achieve. So they were cool with it. Even people at my job, because they knew I wasn't leaving for another engineering corporation, they knew my drive, they knew my work ethic, and they were fully supportive. No bridges burned, and I'm now working with a few people from my past company. Some of the friends, on the other hand, were actually a bit tricky. There's a lot of people that, me being in Calgary, which is an oil and gas town, leaving an oil and gas job in a time where everyone's getting laid off and I had one of the most secure positions, I still to this day struggle with some friends sort of not believing in it and not really liking the idea of this image because they don't really understand what I'm doing, where I'm trying to go. So you see both sides of it, but at the end of the day, man, now I get messages from people almost every single day on either LinkedIn, Instagram, or Facebook saying that just by watching me on Instagram, I've inspired them to chase their dreams, achieve bigger goals, and reframe and restructure their lives to do what they're passionate about. So just me by living my life, inspiring people to do that, is it's all I need to keep pushing.
Yeah. And then once that $15 million listing pops, dude, you just take a picture of the commission check there on Instagram and they'll be like, oh, now I get it.
Now they get it, man. And that's the thing, right? Like, we all know that until big things happen, they might not be there, but when it does happen, they're going to be the ones by your side. So, you know, I just keep my head down, stay focused and focus on listening to the ones who do support. And even if they have constructive criticism, that's great too, as long as I know that they're there for me at the end of the day.
Yep. Yeah. I love it. And I love that you brought that up because so many people take constructive criticism as haters. And I'm like, there's a big difference between a hater and somebody that's delivering constructive criticism. And a lot of people, I think their skin's not thick enough to be able to tell the difference. And all right, so let's fast forward, man. So you get licensed, you jump into this space, you know, beginning of April, you know, right? So, but we're also in a space where 90% of realtors fail in the first 3 years, and you come out of the gate, you know, I mean, massive hustle, of course, but doing big things out of the gate. So like, what do you start doing day one where you're starting to create that success that you've already created in 4 months that most people aren't doing in their first 4 years?
Oh man. First day was absolutely crazy. First day I got my license and started, it was -5 degrees. It was snowing here in Calgary. And I went out in the evening in a suit in the snow and door knocked for 3 hours. And that very first day, I got my first $700,000 listing that closed yesterday. So, awesome. You know, I just went out there and I was like, how am I going to hit this hard? And how am I going to put myself out there in the best way and get the best results I can? And I saw what some other agents who you've interviewed have done. And they're like, you know what, get in front of people, start calling. So if it was colder than -5, man, I'd cold call. And if it was warmer than -5, I'd suit up and I'd hit the doors. I've been slipping on ice and dress shoes. It's crazy. Like, I've fallen on my ass. But at the end of the day, it's the results that speak for themselves. And now I'm building up the CRM. And just by getting out there and doing what others in my town are sort of afraid to do, really set me apart. And then the other thing is, I was never into social media leading up to real estate. If you looked at my personal page, I had, I think, 33 posts over the 2 years that I owned it. None was any pictures of me. And just, again, watching some of your videos and what other people are saying, I dedicated to doing minimum one post a day, every single day, when I got into real estate. And that started building the image up real quick between that and the branding I used with my car.
Yeah. So then fast forward 4 months. I mean, are those still your two main strategies, still door knocking and still social media?
100%. I like I say, if it's nice out, it's summer, I go door knock in the afternoon and then also in the evening, because I find that's when everyone is home. If it's rainy, I'll do some cold calling, but otherwise it's, again, being very active on social media, and getting out there and networking. And now with my car, every time I leave my house, people see that thing and they know who it is. So I'm being active no matter where I go.
Yeah. So we'll kind of dissect these. So with door knocking, and what I love about you, dude, is you didn't just jump. So many people just jump into real estate. They get licensed and they're like, well, now I'll try to figure out what to do. Like, yeah. I got these people that call me up like for the boot camp. Like, well, I'll join the boot camp after I get licensed. I'm like, no, dude, you join it before you get licensed.
Yeah.
And then the second you get licensed, you have a game plan. And that's what I did too. You know, as I was going through schooling, I went and started interviewing, you know, this was 2005, so YouTube and podcasts didn't really exist. Yeah. I'm interviewing every top producer. So the second I had a license, like, I had a game plan in place. So you've been watching the podcast, you did the same thing and hit the ground running. You didn't have to waste your first 90 days in real estate figuring out what the hell to do. Give us kind of a quick sample of what your door knocking script is.
Yeah, yeah. And like I say, just to touch on that point, I speak so heavily to what you just said is I have agents who reach out to me almost every day who say, Mike, I'm considering getting my license. What do I do? And I tell them, do what I did. The first 8 months leading up to real estate, I watched every YouTube video, watched every article, and got myself prepared. So day one, I had the website, the card, the business cards, I had everything so I could hit the ground running. In terms of my door knocking script, so It's a variation between things like Kevin Ward, Tom Ferry, but also adjusting it based on who answers the door. So I always say, hi, my name is Mike Sherrard. I'm with Remax. The first thing I say is, don't worry, I'm not going to ask you to sell your house. Because that way they get, oftentimes if you say, hi, do you want to sell? They get standoffish and they're like, no, of course I don't, go away. But what I do is I just let them know, hi, my name is Mike Sherrard. Don't worry, I'm not going to ask you to sell your house. I'm just letting you know that I've been quite active in this area. The market's doing very well. Some people have been reaching out to me with questions about the market or asking for free home evaluations. Just wanted to see if that might be of interest to you. So I sort of lead with providing value in a very standoffish way to make them feel comfortable and not like I'm soliciting them. From there, what I do is I tailor it to each and every person. So because I'm such a car guy, if they have a nice vehicle in their driveway, I've got them like that. I start talking about their car. I rope them in. They know I'm a car guy. They see my car everywhere. And we can build that relationship very quickly based on a common passion. I'm also a dog person. If they have a dog, I start talking about their dog. So, and kids is another big thing. I sponsor a kids sports program here in the city. And I let them know, you know, if they have young kids, give me your email and I'll set you up with some of the young kids sports programs that I provide charity work for and things like that. So then they know I'm out there in the community. I'm helping, I'm giving back. And it's twofold. They see that I'm helping them in not just real estate, but life. And they see me as a resource for multiple things in the community. And I get their email. So once I get their email, I plop them into the CRM, give them the monthly market report, and they never forget my name.
Yeah. No, I love that, dude, because it's like, you know, I door knock very heavily for open houses and we'll hit like the 500 closest neighbors. And of those 500, you know, let's just say we get 100 that actually answer their door. And of those 100, I might get one listing that says yes, right? Well, what about those other 99 people that I have those conversations with? I need to get them into my database. And you're going deep into the connection because real estate's it's a long-term game, man. You know, most people aren't looking to buy and sell at this moment. So I love the connection, dude.
It's huge. Yeah. Just like you said there, and that's when I first started door knocking, that was the one thing that I was missing is that I was just getting out there saying my little scripts and I wasn't really converting. I was more so focusing on just getting my butt out there and being active and proving that I can overcome this fear of getting in front of people and just be in the space. And then once I got very comfortable with door knocking and rejection, then I was like, okay, it's time to switch it up and start converting and getting emails. So I sort of flipped the script a bit. And now I just carry my cell phone with me, document the emails. And then, like you say, it's a long-term game. I got a couple of emails the other week from people that I door knocked months ago. Like, hey, I remember you and I remember your face. I've seen your car. I'm thinking about buying in the next few months or selling in the next few months. Let's get together.
Yep. Love it, dude. Now, do you just out of curiosity, man, do you use any apps when you're door knocking that kind of track your path or anything that you're doing there that you recommend to those that are listening?
Not really. All I try and do is make sure that I keep notes open. I keep notes open so that I can document their address, their their name and their email, but also anything, any little key thing that I noticed about them. So if I do notice that they had young kids or a certain type of dog or a certain vehicle, I always write that down so that when I do reach out to them again, I can, they'll know that I actually took into consideration their life as a whole and what I noticed about them. Because as you know very well, it's the small details that count and make the biggest difference. And if they know that you paid attention and they weren't just one in a million like everyone else, it means something to them.
Yep. Yep. Love it, dude. Okay. So then, man, let's talk about your car, because you talked about your car a few times and people are probably like, what the hell is this guy talking about this car, man? Like, how are you using a vehicle to leverage this? I know that this also goes in your Instagram, but you're also using it to leverage with door knocking. And then of course we'll lead into the Instagram and social media, but talk to us about your car.
Yeah. So I'm a huge car guy. It's always been my passion, and that's sort of what got me into engineering as a whole as well. So going into real estate, I always had a BMW and I got a new one, a four-door, because my previous was a two-door. And I wanted to find a way to tap into a passion that would allow me to stand out. Because what I see so many realtors doing is they do the bus benches, and because it's kind of old school and they think it works. But then you kind of blend in and you're one of a million. And I realized, how can I be authentic, true to myself, and make a point that people know is honest and transparent? So I said, let's leverage my car. And what I did is I picked purple. Now, purple is a color that, one, stands out. But when you look at color psychology, it represents things like royalty, luxury, and innovation. And I wanted to be innovative with my business, but I wanted people to feel like they're getting the royal experience regardless of the price they're looking at, and feel like they're being treated like luxury. So what I did is the first day I got my license, I wrapped my car in a color called matte metallic purple. And now people know it as the purple realtor on Instagram. And they see the car everywhere because it's a one of a kind. So everywhere I go, they know who it is and it stands out. And I get compliments from people of all age groups because it's, yes, it stands out, but it's very tasteful. It's not obnoxious lime green. It's something subtle that is become widely known.
So when you wrapped it, did you put any type of like call to actions on there, photos on there? I mean, what else is included in the wrap, or is the wrap just the color?
It's a little bit of both. So initially when I was working with my design team, I had them try and design it, and they put my logo, which is a phoenix, like all over it, and tried to make it sort of very real estate typical, just in your face, big, over the top. And I said, you know what, that's not the vibe I want. I don't want to be that solicitor. I don't want to be that guy who seems so salesy. So on the car, it has my logo. I don't know if you can see the phoenix here, but it's there, angled on the hood. And then I have my website in black along the bottom so that you can only see it when the car stopped. I didn't want it to be white and too in your face. And then on the bumper, in the back bumper, it says Sherrard Real Estate. So if you're driving behind me, you know I'm a realtor. If you're parked beside me or you're posted up beside me, you know my website. So every time I drive, I get 10, 15 new views on my website and my Facebook page. And then the logo, how I creatively place it at an angle on the hood, people love it. And I get people asking me all the time, how did I do that? Where did I get it done? They just think it's so tasteful, so creative. That it really stands out in a positive way.
Yep. Yeah. When I was actively selling inside my team, I mean, I always had wrap vehicles, you know, from Hummer H2s to, you know, I had a wrap moving truck as well that was parked all around town, and I would use it to store. Cause like I had to have a place, a storage to store my, you know, 600 open house sign to store shit anyway. So I'm like, well, why not buy a vehicle and then wrap it. And then like with the vehicle that you have, you need a vehicle. It's vastly different than a bus bench. Cause I don't need a bus bench. But any vehicle, I've got a vehicle anyway. And even those of you that are watching and listening that can't afford a wrap because it can cost a few G's or whatever, I started with just the magnets. And I've literally had people pull me over on the side of the road just because they saw my car magnets, you know, because they drove by a house and then they saw me and wanted to go look at the house. And it gets attention. It works. It absolutely works. And you have it anyway.
Yeah. And like you say, even if you have a white car and you have a logo, put the logo on it, but do it creatively. Cause I know so many people that just plop it on the side or right on the front of the hood, like a NASCAR, you know, that kind of comes off as cheap. But if you find a creative way to put your branding on there, that's also tasteful, people get a bit excited about it because they know that it's different. They know you put a bit of thought into it, And that's you. And they'll reach out to you for that very reason.
Yeah, love it. All right, so you got the car going. That's getting a lot of branding, getting a lot of attention. You got the door knocking doing it. Sounds like you're door knocking consistently several hours every day. Okay, then walk us through your social media strategy, you know, and just to take a pause, what I love about what you're doing is so many people try to go out the gate and do 10 things.
Yeah.
I'm like, success is doing a few things brilliantly thousands of times, not trying to do 1,000 things. So you're laser focused on just a couple things and doing those things brilliantly. And again, you've just created some huge results in your first few months. So walk us through social media and how you're doing that to leverage everything else you have going on.
Yeah, and I completely agree with what you just said, because going into real estate, I watched so many videos and saying that you should use Pinterest or Snapchat and this and that. And I had plans actually written out on a Word document on how to use everyone down to a T, how it was going to do it, what I was going to do. And then when I started, I just realized that that takes so much time away from what actually gives you business, and it becomes overwhelming. And then you get caught up and it's just sort of an endless circle. So what I did is I stuck to Instagram for the lifestyle aspect of it. So I do a lot of my lifestyle stuff on there. So you'll see personal shoots of me at open houses, things with my car, me out and about, showing that I do have a life. So I have a couple things with friends, but a lot of it's business and the branding. And then I used Facebook more for educational and informative purposes. So I use my Facebook business page more for my blogs, information for first-time home buyers, how to sell your home for top value. So providing value, because I find people were really engaging on reading my posts there. And then I use LinkedIn for the more professional side of things and educating people there about my new listings or different things that they can do. So going into it, I wanted to be consistent. As you know, being a guy who's into the gym and fitness, the only way you're ever going to get results in the gym is if you are consistent every single day with what you eat, with how you train, and what you do in the gym. Real estate is the exact same way. I knew that if I wanted to get results on social media, I had to be consistent. And every day I had to put out content, but it had to be good content. It had to show what I'm truly doing in the business. It had to give them an idea of who I am as a person and what I'm doing with my life. And that's what spun interest is. People are seeing my car, but they're also seeing me out door knocking, holding up like my flyers, stuff like that. They see that I'm out there being active. I'll use the stories. They see that I'm in meetings or they'll see that I'm networking with some really high and interesting people, and it got them engaged. So that was a big thing, is just being consistent and engaging with the people who are following me.
So then, okay, we've talked about your posting strategy, but posting is irrelevant unless you have followers.
Yeah.
Right. So now, did you go back and you know, it's like, okay, hey, these 700 people that I help manage at this engineer firm, and go out there and intentionally try to friend request and follow them and connect with them on LinkedIn? And, you know, were you intentional about developing those followers, or what are you doing to create those followers?
Yeah, that's an amazing question. So because everyone in my engineering group, and unfortunately the majority of the younger people got laid off, almost everyone that I was working closely with was in the older age demographic that didn't use social media. So I truly started from scratch, because my personal account only had about 200 people. So maybe I had 200 people from Facebook who started following me. But what I did is I started tapping into the communities that I knew would relate to me. So I started using hashtags from local car meetups. Euro Cars and Coffee is a big one here, where it's the exotic meat where all the car nuts go. So I started using that hashtag, and different communities that I knew that would relate to how I dress, the fitness community, the car community, the grind community, those who are entrepreneurs. I knew that all those people would relate to my hustle and what I'm doing. And that's how the following started coming up real quick, because they started relating and getting some engagement that way. Now, after that, I started digging a little bit deeper, and I started sort of being active on there with other people. And, you know, the big thing was just leveraging what I knew people could relate to. So you have to find those communities and and build it up. Because if you're just being like every other realtor and posting homes, they're not going to be interested in that because there's 1,000 others in the community. If you start building up some response based on your passions that others tap into, that's when things are huge. And then I started ranking first on all of those hashtags, getting shout outs from different people like that. And that built it up very quick.
So to give those that are watching and listening an idea, right? Because you've only been, it sounds to me, really intentional with this for about the last 4 months.
Yeah.
What type of business has just social media, because you're not buying ads or paying for ads, it doesn't sound like, you're just being very intentional with your posting and how you post. What kind of business has this generated in the first few months that you've been hardcore with this strategy?
Yeah. So in the first few months, it's given me almost exactly to a T 50% of my business, whether it be through referrals on people who see me on there or from people who see me on there and want to work with me directly. And the response has been amazing. And for example, I had someone the other day who wants to list a high-end home, and they could go to anyone. They could go to the person who has 100 bus benches. They could go to someone they know, one of the big names. But what they said is they reached out to me and said, "Hey, Mike, I want to reach out to you and I want to work with you because I want someone to hustle as hard as you do every day to sell my home." Because they see me, man. I get up at 4 every day and I'll post a snap of me driving to the gym. I answer all of my emails between 4 and 4:30 in the morning. And that drives crazy results because people are like, "Man, what are you doing up at that time?" I'm like, "I'm out here trying to work to get the job done for you." So it does amazing results because people can get a taste for the real you on there. And that's another thing that I want to preach to all those who want to start leveraging social media, especially Instagram, is find your niche, find your path. Whether you're the person with a parrot and you want to be the person with a bird on your shoulder in every picture, find a way to separate yourself, but do it in a way that's transparent and honest. Because I see so many people that try and copy what others are doing, and that's great and all for certain things. But people like to follow you when they know that you're doing something different and it's a bit exciting, right? So that's what happened with me in the cars. And my advice to everyone out there, if you have a passion, try and tap into that and leverage it, whether it be pets or certain vacations, anything, your kids, leverage that to the fullest, because there's always going to be a community out there that can relate to that. And when they see that, they can meet you on a common ground from day one and you guys have something outside of business to talk about, that breaks huge barriers and is such a big icebreaker to start off the ground strongly with.
Yeah, that's such a brilliant time just to be in business and to be alive, because people can connect with us. I mean, you get to a point where you meet with somebody from a listing presentation and they already know about you or like, I've got kids and they like, I've had people that I just go to shake their hand. And they're like, "Actually, can I give you a hug? I already feel like they already feel like they know me on a deep level because of social media." Right. And there's never really been a time out there that's existed like this if it's done right. So,
I was door knocking the other day and it was someone, the woman must have been in her mid 50s, and I put purple laces on all my dress shoes. And I was just giving my script and she looked down at my shoe and she's like, "I got a random question for you. Do you happen to drive a purple car?" And I'm like, "Yes, I do." She's like, "Oh my gosh, I've been following you on Instagram for so long. I've been wanting to meet you. I knew you lived down in this area." I'm like, "Well, I'm at your door now, no better time. So let's chat." And she became a great contact, good for referrals. And like you say, they just feel like they know you from day one because you're being honest and transparent and you're being yourself. You're not trying to be anyone else. You're not fooling anyone. Just be real.
Yeah, love it. So then when you talk about 50% of your business, because somebody might be listening to this and thinking, "Well, he's only been in the business 4 months. If he's only done 2 deals, that's only one from, whatever." Yeah. And I know you've done much more than that. So what does that look like? Is that like 8 deals from social media and I get that a lot of these maybe haven't closed. It might be listings or current clients that you're working with, but it's been such a short time. Just kind of give, because I think too many people discount the power of these strategies.
Yeah. Exactly. So just to give you an idea of where I sit right now, I've had 6 transactions close between sellers and buyers. It's half and half, actually. I have 5 active listings right now, and I have 2 coming up, plus the private one. My average price has been within $600,000 to $800,000 for almost all of my business. So starting out of the gate, it's been sort of in that mid range. I don't know what the average is down there, but sort of in Calgary here, the average is about $500,000. So I've been just above the mid range, dealing with some of the higher end stuff, and now the 15 mil spot. So my business has been, between listings and closes, I've gotten about seven deals through social media, and all of which have been between that kind of $600,000 to $700,000 range, which can provide a pretty significant return just for posting once a day. And that's all it is, man, is being consistent, and it's people who are referring me to their parents or just see me posting in their geographic area. And it's big numbers, it's humbling to know that people are willing to refer someone who they've never met for such a big decision. Us knowing that real estate is one of the biggest financial investment people ever make, just from social media. And when you step back and think about that and look at what's happening in the future, that's huge. The importance that you should place on that.
Yep. And again, man, I mean, those that are watching and listening, we're talking about less than, 4 months of the time. I mean, it's from April 1st to July 19th or 20th today. So, such a short amount of time. So walk us through like what a typical day is for you. Cause you talk about getting up early, hustling hard. Like what does a typical day look like for you?
Yeah, let's do it. So that's an awesome question. People ask me a lot all the time. So, alarm goes off 3:55 AM, 7 days a week, does not move. So I get up, sort of wake up, have a glass of water, do my emails between 4:30, 5 o'clock every day. I hit the gym. I hit the gym for about an hour and a half. I do an hour weights, half hour cardio or whatever. And then I freshen up, and by 7 o'clock I'm working. So 7 o'clock, I finish off some emails. I start doing some market research or drawing up contracts, doing my CMAs, whatever it might be. And then around 9:30, 10, I start being really active. So on my calendar, on my phone, every day I have 10 a.m. until 1 p.m. blocked off. I will not take meetings between that time. That is me prospecting, whether it be cold calling or door knocking. So for those sort of 3 hours, 2.5 hours, I go out there and I hustle. I try and hit my meetings in the afternoon. And then the evening is very hit or miss depending on what I'm doing. So I'm either doing showings in the evening or meetings. If I don't have any meetings or showings in the evening, I door knock. I find you get amazing results when you door knock in the evening, because that is when everyone is home from work. You know, when I do it sort of midday, it's again hit or miss, because you don't know who's home, who's working. As you mentioned, sometimes you get 500 homes, you get 100 responses. The response I get and the conversions I get in the evening is massive. So whenever I have the opportunity, I go out there and I hit it in the evening. And then I sort of stop around 9 p.m. because 9 p.m., 8:30 is when people are starting to put their kids to bed. And that is to the point we are going to sort of annoy them when you're door knocking, because they're trying to do other things like put the kids down and you just get angry people. So after 8:30, I go back and I start responding to the rest of my emails and do any other business. And then from 10 until 11 or midnight, I do education. So I watch YouTube videos, I read books. For those last 2 hours of my day, I try and do everything I can to learn more, better myself, take in more knowledge to see how I can enhance what I'm doing and maybe put a new spin on things to get better results.
Yeah, love it, dude. Love it, man. Then from there, what I know you talked about earlier with your partner, and potentially getting into, development down the road and whatnot. But now that you have a taste of what this business is and how fun and exciting it is and how passionate you are, what do you see your vision with your real estate company? Is it at this point just to eventually get that name where then you can merge those two, or do you see yourself growing, kind of separating those and growing a massive real estate company or team and then doing that in addition to it?
Yeah, I think like you say, it's going to be a bit of both in parallel. So my plan right now is to be solo for about another year and then start bringing people on. So I want to build a team of sort of like-minded, passionate car people, driven people, social media people. I'm going to be very picky, as you know, with people who come on under me, because I want them to be a true reflection of what people know me for, which is being those active social media members and other sort of passionate enthusiasts. So my vision is over the next 5 years to build a strong team of agents. And then over there, I want to just manage the team as sort of like a CEO level, at a high level, and focus on big league stuff. So I want to be doing large scale development in Canada and the States, large scale investing, sort of taking a bit of the Grant Cardone route with, sort of investing in anything 16 units or higher, building a return. And I also have a big passion about doing speaking. So a few weeks ago, I spoke on stage with one of the guys from Million Dollar Listing on how to use social media in real estate. And getting up on that stage and just having hundreds of people look to you and admire, that feeling was absolutely amazing. So honestly, in parallel with real estate over the next 5 years, I'm working with a couple people to create sort of some online programs, but also start doing more speaking. I'm presenting in front of people recently on how to buy your first home, different things to watch out for, how to get in the industry. So speaking in front of people, coaching, mentoring, that is going to be another aspect of it, because people often seek me for advice on that. So if I can give back, but also flip it into something and like an additional revenue stream down the road, once I've achieved a certain stature, then that would be nothing short of a dream and a pleasure.
Yeah. Love it, dude. Love it, man. So, you know, I know that it's only been a few months, and maybe you don't know the answer to this yet, but I want to ask it just because we all, you know, we can talk about the successes, but at the end of the day, we all have, you know, I hate the word failure, you know, because it's really not a failure unless you frickin' quit, you know, right? But, but those failed moments can become our greatest learning experiences. So if you could go back now, knowing everything that you know now today, and give yourself a piece of advice or two pieces of advice that maybe you missed initially and it took you a little while to learn those things, that you feel would have just fast forwarded your already rapid success, what would that look like?
So a couple things. One of them is definitely knowing who you want to work with. When I got into the game, even just recently, I was working with anyone and anything. I was taking any listing. I was working with anyone. And what I realized is that sometimes the quality isn't there. And sometimes it's going to put you through more stress than good. If you're working with people who maybe don't know what they want and just personality conflicts, it's not, the quality isn't there. And what I've seen a lot of the times is that you choose who you want to work with, and that will make your life so much less stressful. If you work with anyone and anything, you're going to work with people that are poor quality. They're going to cause you stress, headaches. They might not buy, even though you've shown them 30 properties. It's not good. But if you choose who you work with and truly vet who you want to work with, it's going to be effortless, because they're confident in you. They relate to you. And that's when you're maybe going to get a bit less business off the start, but the business quality and the conversion and timeline on getting the job done is going to be way less, and is going to put you through less stress. So that was a big one for me, is knowing that, like, I've even terminated a contract with someone because I realized that, you know what, they're just causing too much stress. They don't know what they want, so I don't know what they want. And when you start picking who you want to work with, that's a big one. Another one is picking your networking stream. So I was going to every meetup under the sun for the first little bit. I was going to all kinds of different networking groups, meetup groups, and I was seeing the same people over and over, and the quality wasn't there, because what they were is almost serial meetuppers, is they were going to every meetup to sort of fill an hour in the day and feel like they're being productive. But you look at them a year later, and nothing in their business has changed. So what I've since done is tap into a few very key networks that I want to leverage. And I also started my own group. I realized that the quality wasn't there in the meetups. So I started my own group called the YYC, which is the area code for Calgary, Dream Chasers Group. And it's all young hustlers between the ages of 20 and 40, driven, motivated. And just by surrounding myself with people and choosing the right networking groups, that has skyrocketed. Because again, like I say, people get in the industry and they want to meet everyone and everyone anywhere they can. And the quality is not there. You got to focus on the quality of the people you're surrounding yourself with and who can actually help you with your business and not just fill an hour in your day. Because as you know, our time is precious. And if we can be out there converting and for another hour, that is big. So you got to look at your time wisely, create a schedule and stick to it.
Yeah, love it, dude. So when you started that meetup group, because I had a good friend of mine who was also on the podcast, Tyler Smith, who's now the owner of Sky Slope, you know, a $100 million plus company and yeah. You know, young cat as well. And that's how he built up his business, man. He got to the point where he's getting 30 referrals consistently a month through creating his own meetup group. So they can be very, very powerful. How did you start it? And how do you get that engagement going inside there?
Yeah. So what I did is like I said, for the first few months, I went to every meetup under the sun. I was going to one a day. It was absolutely insane. And I realized that there was a couple people in each group that were true young hustlers. They had big dreams. They were going after it, doing big things in their space and very admirable. But the rest of the people in there, like I said, weren't really that passionate. They were just kind of going there to fill some voids in their day. So what I did is I realized, okay, I need to be more cautious with my time and I need to get something that is actually going to help build my business, but allow me to help others build their business. And I just took, I sort of handpicked a few people from each group and I brought them to a restaurant and I rented out a room and I said, listen guys, this is my dream. I want to create a group of people that are between the ages of 20 and 40, doing big things in their space. And after I explained to them what my vision was, we had four referrals in the very first meeting between the group members. There was only 9 of us. And ever since then, we've had referrals each week from bringing on new people. But I have to vet every single person that comes into the group. So that way, one, there's no overlap. And two, the quality stays consistent. So it was, again, just realizing that there's other people like you out there. You just have to find them. And people start getting drawn to what you're doing. And when they see that you're doing big things, they gravitate towards that. And they want to be a part of that because they know it's either you join what we're doing or you're going to get left behind. And in a year, you're going to regret it because you're seeing the results we're coming up with. And it's admirable. And people get excited about it, you know? So what we started doing with this group is each week we pick a different topic. So the one that's coming up this Monday, people want to understand how to use social media better. So I'm presenting to the group on how to enhance everyone's Instagram presence. And there's a girl in our group who's explaining how to get better conversion on Facebook. So the next meet, we might we talk about a different topic. So each week, we try and educate each other on how to get better in our own space. And since we have so many different bit lines of business and different personalities, it's absolutely amazing because you learn a ton when you're open.
Yeah, that's badass, man. I love it, dude. So, you know, I started this podcast because I wanted to go back and give back to an industry that's 100% changed my life and changed, you know, your life as well. And so that being said though, you know, people that are watching and listening to this, I mean, they're in that position potentially where you were at, you know, 4 or 5 months ago of whether they're thinking about jumping into real estate or maybe they're in real estate and they're struggling and, or maybe not struggling. They just want to take their business to the next level. So with that being said, man, do you have any last piece of words or inspiration or advice you'd like to leave our listeners with so they can go create the life they know they want and deserve?
Definitely, man. If a couple things for people who are getting into the industry, if you're getting into the industry, there's two things I recommend. One, before you even make the decision to take your license, please shadow someone. That's what I did. You know, I shadowed a top realtor in my city for a day and I saw what he does through and through, from his cold calls in the morning to his affirmations to his meetings. And I realized that's something that I can do and I can do well. But what a lot of people don't realize is they see the $1 million listing on TV and they get sort of wrapped up in the facade that it creates. And they feel like they're going to get in the industry and they're going to sign up with a brokerage that's going to give them leads and they're going to be doing these $1 million deals right out the gate and life is amazing. It's not like that. So if you don't know what it's like, please shadow someone and get a feel for what your day is actually going to be like. Because one, when you leave the corporate world, it can be lonely because you're used to being surrounded by people every day. When you're alone, you're alone and no one is there to hold you accountable. but yourself. So if you don't want to do the prospecting, you don't do it, but you need to, you know? So that's one advice to people who are considering getting into it. Now, once you've decided to take your license, again, Josh, like you and I talked about, be proactive. Identify who you want to be, the image you want to create, and how you want to market yourself months before you've actually started. So in parallel with taking your license, go out there and get a feel for how you want to brand yourself and the marketing techniques you want to leverage, the business you want to create, so that when you come and day one, you're not tripping and stumbling. You're ready out of the gate to start hitting it hard and being very cautious with your time and leveraging it. For people who are in the industry, but are looking to take it to the next level, look at those who are doing what you want to do, you know, like look at top agents and see how they've gotten there. Meet with them. I have people who have been in the industry for 10, 20 years, and they meet with me on how I can help them with their social media. And at the end of the day, some people think that it's just a dog eat dog world. And at times it is, but there's enough business out there for all of us to get plenty. So if you reach out, people are often thrilled for you to reach out to them and say, you know what, can you help me with this? Can you give me some advice on this? I'm struggling with this. How can you help me? Just don't be afraid to reach out. You know, we're all chasing a dream. We're all chasing financial freedom. And if you put yourself out there, they're going to respect you for it. And ultimately it'll help you grow and get to where you want to be.
Yeah, powerful words. Couldn't agree more. And those that are watching, listen, I know I end every podcast with this, but information without implementation truly is just the start of delusion. Information is a power. It's taking that information, taking action on it, that then creates that power inside your world. So you can go out there and create that life that you know you want and deserve. And Mike shared so many amazing pieces of advice with you guys today. Take something that you learned. Don't wait. Take immediate action on it. And again, that way you can go out there and create that life you know you want and deserve. And thank you guys so much for watching. Listen, Mike, man, this has been a huge pleasure, huge honor having you on the show, my friend. I appreciate you being here, dude.
Likewise, man. Again, like I said, I predicate much of my success to your videos. So I thank you so much. This is such an honor to do it so early in the game. And I look forward to chasing the dream with you.
Yep, 100%, my friend. All right, you guys, thanks again. And we'll see you next time.
Take care, guys.